What's going on, guys? Welcome to the video. So today we're going to cover everything that you need to know about IP claims, copyright claims, trademark claims, you name it, any claim on Amazon. I'm going to outline why these happen when you sell on Amazon, what you can do to address them, and how you can prevent them going forward. So if you're dealing with these currently, or maybe you're worried about fighting them in the future, stick around for the entirety of this video because it's really going to help you out. I also want to stress that while these types of claims can happen when you sell anything, the majority of these claims, at least in my experience, happen when you're doing coupon arbitrage specifically. So before we actually get into anything, the easiest way to avoid them is to simply pick a different form of arbitrage. Like we always talk about, there are many on this channel. And there are so many other ways to make money doing online arbitrage that you don't solely need to rely on coupon arbitrage like you used to. It's not nearly as lucrative as it used to be anyway, and it comes with a lot more friction from other sellers. So it's important to keep that in mind. Also, I did get several people reaching out to me saying that they missed the Black Friday and the Cyber Monday sales. So if you're in that boat, I'm gonna extend it to 5 more people and 5 more coupon codes to get an online arbitrage pro 3.0 for 50% off. If you're interested, it's the first link in the description for the first 5 people to claim through it. So let's hop in and cover everything that you need to know about claims on Amazon and how you can address them. You have to understand that Amazon is a buyer and customer obsessed marketplace. Okay, they're a buyer centric marketplace. So there currently seems to be no repercussions to other sellers filing continuous claims. Now, this will most assuredly change in the future, but right now, currently, they're allowed to just keep filing them. But that will 100% definitely change. It's just a matter of time. So Amazon shoots first and asks questions later when it comes to their buyers. And their buyers clearly are in quotation marks here because obviously that's another seller that's doing that, but they're just using their buyer account. So leave it up to Amazon. I wouldn't get into the nitty gritty and report them or anything like that. Leave it up to Amazon to figure that out. What usually happens in my experience is if you start reporting other sellers all the time, well, then it's going to put your account under scrutiny. What I've noticed is everybody always thinks like Amazon as this like single entity, this all-powerful selling marketplace entity. Amazon's out to get you. Amazon's doing this and that. Amazon has this policy and Amazon doesn't want you to do this, but Amazon will let you do that. Amazon is it's a cohesive unit of employees, right? Obviously they have their policies, but the employees are the ones that enforce them. So every single time you call Amazon seller support, every single time you email their seller support, every single time you file a claim, the person that's dealing with that is an employee. Now, that's a different employee most likely every single time. Now, some employees are more helpful than others. Some employees are having a bad day. Some employees are having a good day. And this is the case in any company. Some employees are more able to help you and understand how to help you and understand more about Amazon than other employees, right? This goes for any company across the board. So what I'm trying to say is some are more willing to help you, some aren't. Some are able to help you and understand that, okay, you're not doing anything wrong, and some aren't. So, and that's going to tie into the fact that just like I'm talking about with their no limit, there's no limit on the amounts of times that you can respond until you get somebody that can help you. The whole thing with that is you want to make their job as easy as possible. The same thing when I talked about shipping products into FBA, you want to ship less amount of products so that you're not making it very, very difficult on the Amazon employee. Because if the Amazon employee, basically, their job's very, very hard, they don't care about you as a seller. They don't care about you as a person. They're just trying to hit their metrics and their quota. So they're just going to figure out that their best way for them to handle it is not receive your items fully because they're on a time crunch. The same thing goes when you're sending into Amazon, and the same thing goes when you're dealing with Amazon seller support, and the same thing goes when you're reporting other competitive sellers that are trying to do this and basically filing all these claims. Yes, you might be right. They might be doing black hat strategies and they might be the ones that are at fault. But if you're the one filing all these potential counterclaims against other sellers, it makes the Amazon employee that gets it their job a lot harder, their day a lot harder, because now they have to look into all these other seller accounts that you're reporting. And who's the common denominator in the person reporting those other seller accounts? It's you. So the easiest way for them, if you look at their psychology, because remember, they are a human being that are dealing with, you know, this issue. They're just trying to figure out the best way to deal with it. And obviously, every single person is somewhat selfish at heart, right? I am too. So are you. And I'm not saying that you're a selfish person. I'm just saying that that's normal. That's an inherent human behavior. So their number one reaction is probably going to figure, okay, well, you're the one reporting 10 other sellers for doing this to you. You're the common denominator. The easiest way to get rid of this problem is to get rid of you, right? Not figure out that the 10 other sellers are the ones at fault. The whole reason I'm outlining that, I went off on a tangent, but I did it for a reason, is because don't stoop down to their level. Don't do the black hat strategies. Don't report anybody else back. Instead, take the high road and deal with it like I'm going to outline for you here. What I'm trying to say is stay above the fold. Stay better than that. Don't bring any more attention to yourself than you have to, because at the end of the day, you want to keep it easier on each specific Amazon employee. You're not dealing with Amazon. You're dealing with a cohesive unit of employees that are all dealing and trying to get through their day. They're just like you if you have a 9-to-5 job. They're just trying to get through their 9-to-5. The best way to actually handle that is just to stay vigilant and respond quickly to any Amazon inquiries or emails. So if they email you and ask to, you know, that you got a report for an inauthentic product and they want to see your invoice, respond fast, respond kindly, be nice to them, be professional, remember they're a human being, and they'll be more inclined to accept you. Okay. Another thing too is, just like other, competitive sellers and the Amazon buyer in quotation marks can file as many IP claims or trademark claims or copyright or inauthentic claims as they want, because there's no repercussions, you can respond with the invoice as many times as you want. So there's no limit to it. What you have to understand is the same person is not going to review your case every single time. The same person is not going to look at your invoice every single time. So if you get a message like that and you respond with the invoice, obviously most of the time they're going to accept it. If they don't accept it, guess what? Change your formatting up a little bit with what you're saying back, reattach the invoice, and resend it back in. Maybe they accept it. Maybe they don't. Guess what? If they don't, you change your format up, you resend it back in, and that's really the formula. That's the best way to combat it. Now, there's obviously three other steps in the four-step process. You have no limit to how many times you can send your invoices in and respond, just like they have no limit to how many times that they can file against you, okay? So use that to your advantage. A lot of people, and I see this constantly with people that get these claims and they stay on their seller account, it's like, people are, you know, they're afraid to do it a couple times. They do it once and then they might respond again with the invoice again and it's not accepted and then they give up. But why? You can do it as many times as you want. You might as well just keep replying. Okay? All right. So before we talk a little bit about, you know, counter notices, the four-step process that I want to go over with you, and, you know, understanding the first sale doctrine and what it means, which is all very, very important, I want to talk about the risks of scaling up quickly, obviously. Now, you know, just like we talked about, other sellers can file as many as they want. Well, there's an inherent risk if you're doing strictly the coupon arbitrage. If you understand the inherent risks, then you'll understand that scaling up more quickly obviously comes with more risk, right? Because the more products you potentially scale, obviously the more potential claims by other potential sellers. So just understand that. I wanted to touch on that really briefly. Now, before we basically jump into this, there is a disclaimer here, okay? So I am not a lawyer, nor am I an expert on topics that I'm about to comment on, right? I'm not an expert. I don't have any law degree. I've never practiced law in any states. So understand that this is not legal advice, nor is this business advice or anything like that. It's simply what has worked for me. I do want to go over my four-step process, okay? But now before I go over my four-step process for dealing with these, I do want to talk about the fact that you are allowed to do this. Now, one of the things that I used to get asked quite often is, you know, am I doing something illegal? Am I not allowed to do this? And you have to understand the first sale doctrine. You are totally allowed, and this is not just for intellectual property. This is the first sale doctrine just in general, but this is obviously an article on the first sale doctrine. But basically what the first sale doctrine is, and you can read this in depth if you want, is you are allowed to resell anything that you buy. You are allowed to resell new items. You are allowed to resell used items. You are allowed to resell something as soon as you purchase it. You are the buyer of that. You have the right via the first sale doctrine. And this is for the United States, obviously. I don't know, you know, global or worldwide. But the first sale doctrine states that you are allowed to resell that item. It is within your legal rights to do so. So you are allowed to resell. You are not doing anything wrong. You don't run any inherent risks from doing so, because the first sale doctrine basically guarantees you that you can resell anything that you bought. Plain and simple. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you buy, you know, from a yard sale and resell on eBay. It doesn't matter if you buy from a coupon website and list it back as new on Amazon. It doesn't matter if you buy from, you know, a retail store like a Target and resell that back on Amazon. You are allowed to do that, okay? So you're not doing anything, you know, against the law. Now, obviously, Amazon is not the US. Amazon is its own corporate entity and they have their own specific rules. So you have to abide by those rules as well. And for those rules, obviously, it, like we already talked about, it goes back to proving the authenticity and, you know, basically the fact that people can claim as many times as they want. Amazon is not the United States. It's its own separate third-party marketplace, obviously, that you don't have control of. So this is strictly covering the legal side of things. Now, this is Amazon-centric, right? So this is my four-step process. So I want you to understand that 90 to 95% of these claims are fake, okay? If not more. A lot of them are coming from other sellers, like we talked about with the Black Hat strategies, that are trying to get you off their listing. Now, unfortunately, this is standard practice now for a lot of other Amazon sellers because Amazon doesn't have any controls in place to prevent these false claims. So those other sellers understand now that they can just file as many claims against their competitors. And then this is not just something, by the way, that's happening in the online arbitrage community. This is happening in the private label community too. This is happening in the retail reselling community as well. It's a technique that sellers use to try to compete now. And Amazon will adjust. You have to let them give, you have to give it time, let them figure it out. They'll come up with an answer for it, and then everything will go back to normal. So they can just file claims against their competitors, whether that's private label competitors, whether that's you as an online arbitrage seller, whatever. And then obviously it becomes up to you to figure out how to deal with it and get the listing back up. So now that we got that out of the way, let's cover the four-step process specifically. And this works a lot of the time if you implement it correctly. So the first thing, like I said, you have to understand that most of them, these are fake. So the first thing I'll do is I'll check to see if the claim is actually legit or not, or if it's bogus. And if Amazon, because you have to understand, is a basically pull your listing down and ask questions later, or shoot first and ask questions later marketplace, like we talked about. So that means what I basically do is they could basically be sending you information on a false claim and they haven't even looked into it yet. Because like I said, they shoot first and ask questions later when it comes from that metaphorical buyer that obviously is the other seller. So that means what I basically do is I run that trademark number that you'll get in the email or the copyright number that you'll get in the email, and I check it for it on websites like USPTO. I'll check to see if it's relevant. I'll check to see if it's there. And I'll also check to see, on top of that, if that's an actual email. So what will happen is when Amazon sends you an email, they'll give you the trademark number that you potentially violated or that the rights owner reported that you violated. So you can check that. You can look into it. They'll also give you an email to contact that seller. You can look at that email. And in my experience, sometimes, quite often, not all the time, but quite often, I'll email that person from a random email address. So I have other email addresses as well. So for example, I have like Bryan at BG Media Innovation. I have, you know, BG, I have all those other ones, right? But then I have other ones that don't have any association with me, like tjones04477@gmail.com. Just completely random, just so I can use for those types of purposes. So what I'll do is I'll email that email from an anonymous email like T. Jones, and that has no, you know, relation to me or my business, and I'll just email it to see if it gets delivered, or I'll email it to see if I get a response, just to see if it's a legitimate email. And a lot of times, believe it or not, like let's say hypothetically I've tried this like 15 to 20 times, more than 5 times, which is quite often, that's almost 33%, right? More than 5 times, it's been an email that is not even a legitimate email, meaning that person that filed the claim didn't even take the time to put in a legitimate email. They literally just filed a claim, put in a false email, and then filed it. So if that's the case, I literally report that back to Amazon, and then I say I try to reach out to the seller, and the email is invalid. And that 99.9% of the time will be enough for them to mark the claim down, for them to just take the claim down as invalid, right? Because that seller didn't even give them a legitimate email for me to contact. So obviously, too, if it doesn't check out on USPTO, you can also report that back. So step two, if everything checks out and it is one of those rare times where you did actually violate a trademark and they're claiming that, you know, there's some patent on the design of the product or whatever, we're not getting into semantics here. If it is that rare occasion where it actually is a legit email, it is a legitimate trademark, then what I do is I keep sending in my appeal, because then obviously there's a trademark in place. So you have to prove that you have an authentic product and you're not manufacturing a knockoff product or an inauthentic product. So what I'll do is I'll send that appeal in 5 to 10 times at least. There is no amount of times that you can appeal. And each time, like we talked about, you might get a different rep. Every Amazon rep is different. Some are more willing to help than others. Some are better at their jobs than others. And some actually understand situations and look at appeals more than others versus some people that, you know, just kind of just throw it by the wayside because they don't care. They're just trying to do their job. Most of the time, when your appeal is rejected, it's simply because the rep didn't care or feel like reading into the appeal or looking into it. They most likely will just keep sending you the same generic response. I get that same exact response. Hi, we need more information. You know, we need an invoice, the report from the rights owner, so on and so forth. They send the same generic one over and over again. They're literally just responding with that response. They're not even taking any time to look into it and respond back. So, like I said, they'll most likely, they're just trying to get it off their desk. They're trying to push it away to get their work done. So you need to get it in front of somebody that's going to care or somebody that's going to help you, and they're going to most likely continue to send you the same generic response. I get that same one. So show them that you're not giving up and you're not giving away. Most sellers just accept that generic response and go away and get frustrated, which from a worker perspective means that they've accomplished their goal, right? They have less work to do. They've basically dealt with the situation when they don't get any emails back. That's their perspective. Put yourself into their psychology. Understand that each person is going to be different. You got to just continually respond until you get it approved. If that fails and you want to try something new, this isn't something that always works, but you can reach out to the seller. So most sellers, if it's not a bogus claim from a competitor, are under the impression that you're an Asian seller trying to sell a fake version of their product. So they're annoyed that you're basically trying to hop onto their listing, list your own knockoff product, and steal their listing. They don't realize that you actually do have their product, that you actually did buy their product, and you actually are a customer of theirs. So sometimes what I'll reach out and I'll say something like, you know, if all else fails and I'm on step three, hey, I received a report from Amazon that said I was infringing on your trademark. I would like to assure you that that was never my intention. I purchased your product and was actually unhappy with what came. When I tried to return it, Amazon wanted to charge me to return the item to them, so I just decided to list it for resale instead. And that's actually true. Amazon will charge you if you don't report it as inaccurate website description, which most people don't know. Amazon will actually charge you to return the item. They'll charge you shipping. So that actually makes 100% sense. And if they're any type of normal, experienced seller, they'll understand that. I was wondering if you wouldn't mind retracting your claim, you know, and then list the claim number, obviously. Now, something along those lines. That changes a little bit every time, but it's usually something like that. So that does a couple of different things. That lets them know that you actually did have the product, and more importantly, you're a buyer, so you have the power to review it bad because you're obviously, you implied that you were very unhappy. It's very important. This is implied. You don't actually say that or do that. You don't actually say, I'm going to review your product bad if you don't, you know, remove this claim. You don't get mean with them. It's implied. It's subtle, okay? So keep that in mind. It's subtle. You don't actually say that. It also lets them know that you only have one other item and you're not planning to hop on their listing long term. So usually that actually works if you can get a hold of the seller. If all else fails, you can file a counter retraction notice, which is this. So you can read the procedure for filing counter retraction notice. You're sending in paperwork to Amazon, which basically initiates them to their seller support team that you don't think you violated anything and you have the authentic product and you're willing to take that to court if you need to. And you basically, what it basically does is Amazon will then notify, once they receive your counter retraction notice, that that other company or the other seller has to file a lawsuit or has to bring you to court or has to take action on that some form or fashion against your counter notice, or they're going to drop the claim. Like I said, guys, remember, this is an extreme example. You don't always want to do this, but this is an option for you if this is step four, if you're at this point, okay? And you don't have to do this. You can just take it and then file a plan of action if you want to do that. But I know people that use this all the time and are very, very successful. And also, like I said before, I'm not a lawyer. You know, I'm not professional legal. I don't understand any of the professional legalities of these things. I just understand what works for me, and I understand what works for other sellers that I network with that do online arbitrage. In about 99.9% of situations, it is so, the other person, the other seller and the other company is going to drop the claims against you. They're going to drop that the copyright filed claim or the trademark filed claim, because if you look at it strictly from a business standpoint, even if they're their own person, you look at it strictly from an economic standpoint, is it worth it? Is it really worth it to not let that person sell one of their items because they're mad? or would they rather go file, you know, have to go file a lawsuit for 10 grand? Because filing a lawsuit costs a lot of money. It's not cheap. And I don't even know if it's 10 grand. It might be more. It might be a little bit less. But what I'm trying to say is, if you look at the economics, nobody's going to want to go find a lawyer, actually go through that process, and then file that and serve you with a summons to you know, basically see them in court. Nobody's going to do that. And in my experience with both myself and the people that I network with, when you file these counter retraction notices, usually it gets dropped because the other person doesn't want to go to the through the hassle of finding a lawyer, paying that lawyer, explaining what happened, then serving you with the papers, then showing up to court, and then, oh, by the way, after all of that, winning the freaking case, which, by the way, you have the actual authentic product that first sale doctrine that we talked about in the beginning allows you to sell, right? So you're not violating any legal laws. Now, like I said this about three times, I am not a legal professional. I just know what works for me and works for other online arbitrage sellers. This is an extreme example, but it is a route that will be very, very effective. You either want the paperwork, you either want, you know, them to prove it, or you want them to drop the case, and that's how you get it done. Usually one, two, or three will do the trick. If all else fails, you can go number four, but obviously you're playing with fire there. About 99.9% of cases will be dropped, but in that 0.001% that isn't, you have to be ready for that. So understand that. That's the four-step claim process. I really hope it helps you.